My institute is involved in studying infection and inflammation in chronic diseases. And you may ask, why study infections? After all, in 1967, the Surgeon General of the United States declared time to close the book. Time to close the book on infectious diseases. We've got penicillin, we can treat all diseases. There's no problems anymore. Well, I don't think there's anything that could be further from the truth, and I think we all experienced it in the last month. In the last month, we realized that we're still at war and that there are infectious agents out there that don't respond to antibiotics, that can't be treated with anything we know about. And folks, if I asked you, how many of you are a little bit uneasy about Ebola? Can you put your hand up? Yeah, there's a couple of tough guys in the back, but I'm not afraid of Ebola. Kick Ebola. Now, if I told that same person, there's a guy sitting next to you that might be infectious. Look at him, he's getting up. All right. So, but Ebola isn't the only disease, of course. And tragically, if you loaded two 747s with kids and crashed them every day, that's how many kids die of infection in Africa every day. It's an astounding statistic. And it's not just in Africa, folks. We've got some problems here in Alberta. We've got little kids that make the front news all the time. This little girl survived an infection. This little boy didn't. And sometimes when these kids do survive, and about 90% of them do, they still leave those hospitals and they have lost limbs, they've got chronic diseases, they've got chronic impairment. And so this is a real, real tragedy, and we have to find ways of dealing with this. And nobody's immune. I know that tough guy's thinking, hey, I'm immune. Well, Superman was not immune, okay? And it doesn't matter how close you get to God, the Pope was not immune. And it doesn't matter how fit you are, because the captain of the Brazilian soccer team also died of infection. Infection can kill anybody. And one of the problems is that the antibiotics that the Surgeon General talked about are no longer very useful. We're developing superbugs in our hospitals and in our communities that don't respond to antibiotics. These are just some graphs showing, for example, hamburger disease is now becoming more and more resistant to certain antibiotics. Pseudomonas aeruginosa, which infects cystic fibrosis patients, becoming resistant. And staph aureus, or staph infections, are notoriously resistant to many different antibiotics. What are we doing about it? Well, pharmaceutical companies have realized, gee whiz, there isn't much money in antibiotics. So in the 80s, we made 16 different new antibiotics in a period of 4 years. 2 decades later, we've made 4, and my understanding is we're making less and less. And so, a different point of view from arguably the Surgeon General, if you will, or the Chief Medical Officer from the UK, Sally Davis, she's declared this as dangerous as terrorism. And we've learned something, actually, from some of our colleagues. So in cancer, people like Terry Fox actually did some amazing things. And at this time point, Terry Fox and others made people aware that cancer is a killer. It's a terrible disease, and we have to do something about it. They made the government aware, and they had bike-a-thons and telethons, and look what happened to the death rate for cancer. It's going down. We need to do the same thing for infections. These are data from our hospitals here, generated by John Conley. This is Staphylococcus aureus infections. We've got to change this trend. Now, this is a patient, okay, who happened to have staph on their leg while they were getting a tattoo. And it doesn't have to be a tattoo. It can be a scrape. You can be playing at the soccer center and scrape your knee. If you get staph aureus, okay, on your skin and into your blood, then you get these kinds of infections. Now, how many of you, when you came here, were worried about Ebola? Many of you. How many were you afraid of staph infections? Not really, huh? Well, I'll tell you, 30% of you are carrying this bug. Okay. Now, if this happens to you, but not on skin, we can still handle skin, but if it happens to your lungs, that far picture, I think you'll all know, even though you're not medically trained, that's bad. That's a hemorrhagic lung. And you end up in the ICU, and we can't find you for the number of doctors that are in there. Okay, let's lighten this a little bit, okay? So you all agree infections are important. Now, how many of you remember the movie Fantastic Voyage? All the 40-year-old men, because Raquel Welch was in there, right? Me too. What they did was they miniaturized a submarine and went right into the body. And we can now do the same. So this is what a microscope looks like in 2014. Not like your biology microscope a few years back. Costs about $1 million, and a bunch of engineers, physicists put it together. We can go right into the blood vessels with this. So here's our patient, okay, up here. And we're gonna look inside the body and begin to try and understand what happens during infections. And so here's a blood vessel, okay? You can see this blood vessel in red. We've tagged the blood vessel red. And we've tagged immune cells green. And so you can now see this guy's gonna get bored and he's gonna actually crawl out of this blood vessel and move on. So now we've got this. We can start looking inside the body. And the green guy that you saw was the neutrophil, the policeman of the immune system. His job, pretty obvious, okay? And he does it with great delicacy, okay? He kills. And he kills the same way you guys do when you get a scratch, okay? Uses hydrogen peroxide or hypochlorous acid, main ingredient in bleach. Okay. So now let's start going around the body and see what happens during infections. So the red are blood vessels, the dark are alveoli. We've now moved into the lung, okay? And the blue are neutrophils. And the neutrophils are constantly patrolling around these alveoli because they have a way of getting to the external environment. Bacteria could come in. And so as you watch this, bacteria, if we infect our patient, bacteria actually will adhere to the vessel walls. Now let's watch the neutrophil in action shown here in yellow. So you can see the yellow neutrophils, you can see the red bacteria, and you're gonna see this yellow neutrophil leap across, grab that bacteria right in the blood vessel, and devour it. That's our immune system at work. And we do a pretty good job in the lung. So you can see down here, that many of the bacteria, even in just 30 minutes, are getting eradicated by the neutrophil. But look at the liver. Maybe not so good. And if you look in the liver, we've got a different kind of cell in the liver. There's a macrophage, or Kupffer cell, that sits in the blood vessels, and it just sits and sticks its arm into every blood vessel. And what I'm gonna show you next is this Kupffer cell. We'll label it purple, and the bacteria in green again. And you're gonna have to watch real quick because these guys are incredible at catching bacteria. And so watch this, purple, green. They just catch them instantaneously. Do you wanna see it again? Purple, green, okay? That's how good they are. It's instantaneous, all right? They catch these bacteria, and most of them will start killing the bacteria, but every so often, bacteria win. Every so often, the bacteria starts replicating. This is a Godzilla Staph aureus. It's getting bigger and bigger and bigger. Well, of course, it's not a single bacteria. It's multiple colonies, and they're growing inside our liver, inside our macrophage, okay? So we're looking at this patient. We've infected him, and inside these macrophage are growing bacteria. What's the neutrophil doing? Where's our policeman? Well, unfortunately, the neutrophil has gone to the pub. It can't find these bacteria because they're hiding inside the Kupffer cell. And you can watch these guys just trek along and just move on as if nothing was wrong. All right? Now, the bacteria grow and grow and grow, and we can put in a dye and watch when the cell lyses, it turns red, and all the bacteria disseminate around the body. Okay? So now we've got a real problem. We've got bacteremia. But luckily, we still have antibiotics. Okay? And so here's an example of an antibiotic, vancomycin, which is really one of our last gasps against MRSA, methicillin-resistant Staph aureus, okay? And so let's give it to our patient. So first of all, here are the colonies in green growing inside our macrophage in the liver. And if we now give the antibiotic and then infect our patient, guess what? The antibiotic works great, all right? There's one flaw with that experiment. Very few patients come to the doctors. John, you've never had a patient come in and say, next hour, I'm going to have an infection, so give me some antibiotics, okay? They arrive when they're infected. So let's do the same experiment, but infect our patient first, and then add our antibiotic. No effect. And in fact, in this video, we've taken the antibiotic and made it bind to bacteria so the bacteria will turn green. Here are our red bacteria inside the macrophage, and none of them are turning green. There's one. It was actually in the circulation, so it died. But the majority of these bacteria are surviving inside the macrophage. So now, you're all part of this experiment. How are we going to treat this patient and get rid of these bacteria? So you gotta think like a macrophage. Think like a macrophage. All right, and this is what one of my postdocs from the Netherlands, a really bright guy, and that's the great thing about working here. I get really good trainees. And so one of my postdocs, Boz, said, I'm thinking like a macrophage. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take the antibiotic and put it into something that looks just like a bacterium. Not bad, eh? Those cells grab that and think it's bacteria. And so he's taken this and he's put it inside these little liposomes, as we call them, and the blue are liposomes, and they're getting taken up exactly where all these colonies are. And in a few minutes, what you can see is fewer and fewer colonies. And that's research. And so now, I don't think you'll be surprised that lots of companies are thinking, hey, maybe we can take those antibiotics and make them work again. Now, you know, imaging and being able to look inside the body, it actually allows us now to identify new things. So let's go for a ride and see what we can find. One of the things I'll tell you is, and I didn't show this picture because I didn't want to, but one of the things you'll find is when kids get infected, they get horrific, horrific problems with their blood clotting. Something happens to their platelets and they don't do well, okay? Their platelet counts drop. And if I'll show you, you all know what platelets are. They're for blood clotting, right? How many of you knew that? Yeah, more than relativity and all that stuff. All right, and so you can see people will give blood, they'll give platelets so that people with clotting disorders, all right, with platelet disorders actually can live and not bleed to death. All right, so let's look at the platelet. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna tag the platelet in red and we're gonna have those Kupffer cells in blue again, those macrophage. And what you can see here is these red dots are the platelets. And they're just touching and going, touching and going, touching and going, touching and going. The blue are the macrophage. Why are they interacting? Now let me show you in slow-mo, so one frame every half second. What you can see is they touch for 1 second, 1.5 seconds, 2 seconds, and gone again. almost like they're patrolling, like they're surveying, like they're looking. Now what happens if you add a bacterium? All right? What we see is the bacterium adheres to the Kupffer cell. It got caught. Look what the platelets do. They form a huge clump, surround that macrophage, okay? And they now try and help to eradicate that bacterium. So, this Kupffer cell doesn't do the job himself. He actually gets help when he catches a bacterium, calls in the platelets. Now that's research, it's basic research. We've just identified something new. Now if you think about it, okay, if you have platelets, you live a nice long time. If you don't have platelets, our patient dies very quickly. Now think about this, okay? And I saw Eldon Smith here. I'm sure that he's prescribed a few of these drugs in the past. If you have a heart attack, okay, if you have a stroke, you have to take these drugs. It's essential, all right? They make your platelets less sticky. They help you so you don't have another heart attack or another stroke. But you know, folks, we're starting to advocate that we use aspirin all the time for everything. It might prevent cancer, it might prevent stroke. And I think we need to do research to understand how we're treating our patients. Is this the right thing to do? We certainly need to do the research to figure it out. All right. Now, this is the neutrophil, okay? And sort of looks a little bit like a lineman. Big shoulders, no neck, okay? The neutrophil also has the property of not being very quick, just like a football lineman, okay? And here is a neutrophil, and you can find this on Google. This is not my video. Here's a neutrophil right here, and it's going to chase after a bacterium in a little tiny well so that it's got a chance of catching this bacterium. And so we can watch this now. And he's chasing, and he's chasing, and he's chasing. We'll leave this bug and we'll forget about this, but we'll just keep chasing and chasing and chasing and chasing. And folks, if this is your immune system, you got some serious problems, okay? So let's take our microscope and look at what it really looks like. And I'll show you what it looks like. The neutrophil has no hope of catching a bacterium. If we go into the joint now and look, the green are neutrophils, okay? And the red are bacteria. Look at how quickly these bacteria move around. Look at the green neutrophil. This guy's actually moving at top speed. There is no chance the neutrophil's ever gonna catch the bacteria. Now for my joke. It's like me trying to catch this guy, right? No way, no way. That's why I'm having a beer. No way. All right. In fact, if you watch this neutrophil, it's much smarter than that. It starts releasing a net and catches all these bacteria, okay? It releases a net, forms these large net structures out of its DNA. It untangles all its DNA and makes these large nets to help catch bacteria. And so now the bacteria, here's our staphylococcus, just surrounded by these nets, if you will, okay? Now, there are drugs out there that actually break down DNA, okay? And sometimes they're important to use, but sometimes we have to be cognizant of the fact they may be important in infections. Think about it. Have you ever seen a spider running after a fly? No, and a neutrophil will not chase a bacterium. All right, we're getting close to finishing now. All right, so once a week, my family turns on the TV and they watch this guy cure another major disease. 60 minutes and the guy's cured another disease, okay? And folks, I'm using this slide to say, research makes a huge difference, but it takes years and years, not 60 minutes, okay? And so I want to introduce you to the spokesperson of my institute, all right? This is Nikki Perkins. And Nikki was born with a terrible, terrible genetic deficiency. One of her proteins misfolds, and she has cystic fibrosis, She cannot clear bacteria out of her lung. And so she was born somewhere between 1960 and 70. She had expected lifespan of about 10 to 15 years. They said, don't put her into school, she'll get an infection and die. But her parents put her in school. And luckily, a discovery came along that allowed us to treat staphylococcus infections. And another discovery came along when she went to high school that helped with her Pseudomonas infections. And then her mucolytics and her inhaled antibiotics. And so I'm pleased to say that Nikki's 40 years old, continuing to speak on behalf of our institute about the importance of research, because she's a living example of how research has prolonged her life by more than 30 years. So what infection's coming next? What should we be worried about next, folks? All right, well, let me show you something. Here's Vancouver Island. Here's the mainland. And each one of these red dots is a new infection, Cryptococcus gattii. It's a fungal infection found only in Papua New Guinea and the northernmost part of Australia. And now it's made it, because of climate change, to Vancouver. All right? These people get terrible fungal infections. They breed the fungus in. And so one of my coworkers, Chris Modi, a respirologist, started imaging this using our microscope. He said, let me have a look. And what he found was that these fungi, okay, will move to the brain and razor sharp edge cuts through and moves into the brain and starts replicating. So Chris now understands the mechanism and is looking for new ways of preventing this from happening so he can treat this disease. His last patient, a year on antifungals to treat a growing infection in the brain. What should we do next? Okay, I hope the dean's sitting now because I'm gonna try and spend some of his money, all right? I think what we should do next is really start to tackle some of these issues. Aren't you glad you're not the dean anymore, Elder? I think that we should build a germ-free facility, a facility that allows us to now start to understand what do antibiotics do when we use them, for example, to affect our microbiome. We've got bacteria throughout our bodies, and it's well known that if you give certain antibiotics, you kill some of the good bugs, and one or two of the really bad bugs takes hold. You get terrible problems. So it's an example of how we really want to understand this. Premature babies, if you're born early, we give you antibiotics. But you know, there's an increasing evidence that these babies develop allergies, autoimmune disease. We need to understand these issues. Cancer, cardiovascular disease, all impacted by impacting the microbiome. Where else do I want to go? Well, next time I take you for this ride, I'm hoping we're doing it in a human. And so we got some physicists, we're hoping to recruit some engineers. We're gonna try and put that big, huge microscope on the tip of a bronchoscope or an endoscope. And it better be small, right, John, if it's an endoscope? So we're hoping to put it on the end of this and be able to go inside and start imaging. And we're making some progress in that area. I wanna go back to Ebola. And the reason people are so worried and scared, and the reason there's so much panic, is we don't have the information. We're not doing the research we need to do to understand this horrific disease. And this is all I could find in the literature from the last 20 papers, 19 were reviews, and then there was this one paper that said this is what the lung of an Ebola patient looks like. There's dead cells, lots of dead cells that line the vasculature, okay? But no inflammation. No inflammation at all. What's amazing about that is, let me show you what happens when you kill a few cells. In the next video, green are neutrophils, red is a few dead cells. Look at this. This is spectacular. This is the immune system in action. And yet with Ebola, we don't get this. Here are platelets binding to various cells when you have viral infections. We know Ebola patients' platelets drop. We don't know where they're going. We don't know what's happening. And so until we do the research on Ebola, until we get some of these microscopes inside level 4 facilities and start doing that research, we really won't understand that disease, and we really won't know what to do with some of these patients. So my take-home messages, I hope you realized infection's a real problem, okay? And the government needs to hear this, all right? 24/7, not just when Time decides it's important, okay, or any other magazine. And research is vital to our fighting these infections. And finally, I think we need to really move forward on doing some of the research that's required on new and emerging diseases so that we don't get our own Canadian version of Ebola. And so I'll stop there. Thank you very much.